medical overview. So this is kind of going to go over what we're going to be getting into for the next couple of weeks, really getting into that medical assessment. All right. There we go. Let's get past all these competencies here. All right. So patients who need EMS assistance generally have experienced a medical emergency, a traumatic emergency, or both, right? Trauma emergencies involve injuries resulting from physical forces applied to the body, where medical emergencies involve illnesses or conditions caused by a disease. So it is important to remember that patients may have a combination of medical and or trauma or both together. All right. So respiratory emergencies are patients that have trouble breathing, or the amount of oxygen supplied to the tissue is inadequate, right? Which can cause respiratory distress, which then can also cause shock, right? Cardiovascular emergencies are caused by conditions affecting the circulatory system. Neurologic emergencies involve the brain, and gastrointestinal, or what they call GI conditions, include appendicitis, diverticulitis, pancreatitis, and many others. Remember that anything that ends in
ITIS
is inflammation, right? Anything that ends in ITIS is inflammation of something. So if you have a diverticulitis, it's an inflammation of the diverticulum. Appendicitis, inflammation of the appendix. Okay, you guys get that?
Yep.
ITIS is important to understand. Anything with ITIS is inflammation. A neurologic emergency involves, Urologic emergencies involve kidney stones or involve the urinary system, right? The urinary tract, kidneys, bladder, right? Although that's anything urologic. The most common endocrine emergencies are caused by complications of diabetes mellitus. All right, hematologic emergencies may be the result of sickle cell disease or various types of blood clotting disorders, such as hemophilia. We start getting into the factor problems, like factor 8, factor 7, factor 6, things like that. Immunologic emergencies involve the body's response to foreign substances. Right, toxicologic emergencies include poisoning and substance abuse, resulting in other types of medical emergencies as well. All right, again, we're going to be covering all these in depth later on in the program. So I'm not going to hit these things hard now. It's more of an overall review, overview of what we're going to be covering coming up. Some medical emergencies are caused by psychological or behavioral issues, and also may be especially difficult to deal with some because patients often do not present with typical signs and symptoms. Then we have gynecologic conditions, which are a special category of medical emergencies that involve female reproductive organs. All right. So as you can see here in this table, the common medical emergencies you're going to see with these. So make it a little bit bigger here. So respiratory asthma, emphysema, chronic bronchitis, your COPDers, right? Cardiovascular, this is talking about heart attack. Congestive heart failure, CHF, myocardial infarction, or an MI, acute coronary syndrome, ACS. Those are more of our cardiovascular stuff. Neurologic seizures, strokes, syncope, right? What's causing those underlying conditions? GI, appendicitis, diverticulitis, pancreatitis, urologic, kidney stones, bladder infections, right? Endocrine, diabetes is our biggest endocrine killer. Hematologic, like sickle cell disease or hemophilia, anything that has to do with the blood, right? Immunologic, anaphylactic reactions, severe allergy to bee stings, food, other substances. We'll talk more about epinephrine, how we administer epi, and looking at the different dosages for pediatric versus adults. Toxicologic, one of my favorite subjects to teach, by the way, is anything with toxicology. All right, so substance abuse, food, plant, chemical poisoning. And you're going to learn a lot about toxidromes. Get used to that name and start reviewing toxidromes early, because I expect you guys to have those memorized. Why? Because this is something we need to come in contact with, like anticholinergic, right? Organophosphate, right? Those are different toxidromes I want you guys to have a full understanding about. Tricyclic antidepressant overdose, using the SALT acronym. A lot of things we're going to be covering in toxicology. Behavioral, Alzheimer's, schizophrenia, depression, suicide, bipolar, all right, manic, all these different things that are out there, have an understanding of all of those. Gynecologic, like vaginal bleeding, sexually transmitted diseases, pelvic inflammatory disease, what they call PID, ectopic pregnancies, right? And different, and then we'll get more into obstetrics as well, which is something else we're going to be covering for different types of births as well. Okay. So again, EMT covers a lot of stuff. And I go just a little bit beyond EMT level because I want you guys to have an understanding of what we are doing and why. I want to get rid of the word technician to make you guys clinicians in the field. Right. This is a lot of fun. This stuff is fun, but you have to want to have the drive to want to do it.
Right? It's so funny. I was totally thinking that the other day, that the word technician, we call our technicians at work technicians. And it's just, it's kind of an old school name.
It is.
You know, they changed all the vocational technical institutes. They took the terms out. I'm surprised they haven't to EMTs either.
Yeah, because they want technicians or cookbook. They teach you what you need to know. And you follow a protocol set. That's great. But if you have a patient having chest pain, right? This is kind of off topic, but we'll go back to cardiac for a minute here, okay? You got a patient right here, cardiovascular heart attack, right? Excuse me. Patient complaining of 8 over 10 chest pain, dull in nature, radiating to the left shoulder, okay? What are we thinking right off the bat? Cardiac, right? Possibly a heart attack. We think about that kind of stuff, right? Blood pressure is 200 over 110. Heart rate of 82. Right? Still thinking heart attack, right? So our treatment plan for an MI is going to be give patient aspirin and assist with nitro, right? But as you're doing a further assessment, you notice the patient has left-sided deficit and weakness. What would that indicate?
Possible stroke.
Possible stroke. What happens if you give a patient nitro? What does it do?
Messes with their blood pressure.
Yeah, something called vasodilation, right? Vasodilation means that you're dilating the vasculature, making the pipes bigger. In turn, will definitely help you lower the blood pressure. But what happened to that clot that was in the brain? Where does that go now when you make the vessels bigger?
You just moved it.
Or that patient's having stroke-like symptoms and has a severe headache. And next thing you know, it's a hemorrhagic stroke with a bleed. And you just vasodilated that bleed. What happens?
Irreversible brain damage.
Just say you killed your patient.
Yeah.
Right? But your protocol says for a patient having acute coronary syndrome, you have to give aspirin and nitro. Right? You're a technician. You follow the protocol book. You still give it knowing that there's a stroke also happening? Would you give it?
If I knew that a stroke was happening, probably not.
No. I would say absolutely not. And you can call medical direction too to have a consultation, yeah. Right? But now you're acting like a clinician looking at the clinical signs using differential, right? This is why I say we're not technicians in the field. We're clinicians, just a different level, right? If you were a cookbook provider, you would just would have killed that patient. But because you thought about it in the field, looking at cause and effect and knowing the medications you can give at the EMT level, the ins and outs of the meds, you chose not to give something because it would cause further harm that you cannot fix in the field. Right? So understand what you're doing, why you do it, cause and effect of everything that we do. That's why it's so important to be a clinician. I hate the word technician, by the way, if you haven't noticed. Right? Unless you're like doing fire department stuff, then you can be a technician. That's fine. But in EMS, in the medical field, we're clinicians, what we do. And I'm going to train you to be like one. Right. Unlike other classes that are out there, I like to make sure that you guys are actually clinicians actually using differential diagnosis. So similar to the assessment of the trauma patient, but with a different focus. This is patient assessment, right? Similar to the trauma. Nature of illness, symptoms, and chief complaint. Nature of illness. What happened? Why are you sick? How long have you been sick for? What symptoms are you having? Chest pain, shortness of breath, dizziness, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, blurry vision, headache, right? All the different things you could be asking for all these pertinent negatives, right? And what is going on? Why were we called to your house today? Chief complaint is different than dispatch reason, by the way. We're going to establish an accurate medical history utilizing sample. What is sample again? I forgot. What is it?
Signs and symptoms.
Okay.
Allergies.
Allergies. Yep. Mechanism of injury? No, that's not right.
Medication.
What is M?
Medications.
Oh, medications. I'm on the wrong checklist.
You're fine. P?
Has no pertinent
palpitations. No.
Nope.
Pertinent information.
Pertinent past medical history.
Yeah, I'm sorry, all my right, microphone's not working. It wasn't.
That's
working.
Fine. What's L?
Last oral intake.
Yep. Yeah. What about E?
What led to what led
the
to
events.
The events? Yeah, the events leading to illness or injury, right? So we use our sample history, and then we get something called an OPQRST. What is that one?
That's what I was thinking of.
Yeah,
that's a good one.
Yeah.
Onset.
Onset.
The pain provocation.
Provocation is what makes it better or worse.
Quality.
So what does it feel like? Sharp, dull, pressure, elephant sitting on your chest, stabbing pain?
Is that when you could also do a pain scale?
We're not there yet.
Okay.
R.
Severity. That's right.
Yep.
The region, if it's moving, radiating.
Yeah, so radiating. S is severity in a scale of 0 to 10.
10. Yep. Without childbirth.
Yep. And then T is?
Time.
Of pain, yeah.
If you look at our associated symptoms and pertinent negatives, right? So this establishes a good medical history. You need to get a good medical history, including family history as well, right? If I was having chest pain right now and you said, Kevin, are you having chest pain? Yes, right? Do you have any family history? Well, my father died of a heart attack at age 42 and I'm 41. Yeah. That should say something to you, right?
Right.
Okay. Do not get locked into preconceived ideas of the patient's condition, right? Do not get locked in with tunnel vision. Tunnel vision will kill your patient. Why? Because you're going to go down a rabbit hole you don't want to go down, right? Look at differential and do your testing. Come up with a diagnosis, right? Injuries may distract from underlying conditions, right? What is Kerr's sign? I know I covered this with you already before. What is Kerr's sign? Who's going to look it up on Google?
I literally cannot remember.
No, I'm looking at my notes. I didn't write it down, which is stupid. Bad.
I wrote it. I just don't know where I wrote it.
Who wants to look it up? I bet it has something to do with the spleen.
Kerr's.
Yep. The tunnel vision, I'm going to go here while you guys are looking it up. Tunnel vision occurs when you become focused on one aspect of the patient's condition and exclude all others, which may cause you to miss an important injury or illness. Kerr's sign.
Oh, yeah. Refer to the left shoulder on gentle.
Oh, the referring pain.
Yes. So if someone is saying, oh, my shoulder hurts, and they were involved in a traumatic incident.
Yeah, could be the liver.
Could be the spleen too, right?
Yeah.
Splenic injuries have referred pain called Kerr's sign to the left shoulder.
Okay.
Right? Where's your appendix located?
Your right lower quadrant.
Yeah. Right. How do you find it? How do you know exactly where it is? The palpate.
Palpations?
Yeah, but you have to find a specific point. So look up McBurney's point. McBurney's point has to do with the umbilicus and the corner of the pelvis and going down 3/4 of the way down from your umbilical down your to the right side. And that's McBurney's point, and you palpate there, and that's where the appendix is located. 1/4 of the way up from the pelvis, 3/4 of the way down from the umbilical.
If it's their appendix and you do hit that, you do look for that McBurney's point.
Yeah.
As soon as you push on it, will they be like, ow?
Oh, they are probably going to punch you in the face.
They will. So that's, yeah.
Significant pain. So they can just be complaining of abdominal pain. You push at McBurney's point and they go, oh my God, that hurts. And you have that rebound tenderness. Probably appendicitis, right?
That's not. Yeah. When we do the four quadrants, a lot of people are sticking right around kind of the belly button. You really got to go down there.
Yes. Kinda, all the way down to the pelvic.
Especially if they're complaining about it.
Absolutely. You should be palpating it either way on any kind of assessment. Shouldn't matter. We have to do a full abdominal assessment and palpate everything. Right? You also want to make sure you can feel 2 centimeters of the corner of the liver. That's normal. Right? The liver located on the right side of the body, correct? Yes? Mm-hmm. Right? So to truly feel it, to truly feel your liver, right? You got to grab your rib cage where your rib cage would be. Take a deep breath in, and on exhalation, you're going to take your fingers, you're going to curl them under the rib cage and palpate the tip of the liver. And that hurts.
Yeah.
All right. But that's how you truly palpate a liver, to make sure you have it. One of the first indications of congestive heart failure in a pediatric is liver inflammation in a pediatric CHF. Adult is different. But a pediatric CHF, one of the first things you're going to find in congestive heart failure is liver inflammation. You've got to know where your organs are located, right? Tunnel vision will kill a patient, flat out. You have to pay attention to the signs and symptoms that are there, and also utilizing your differential diagnosis and all your tools of the trade, right, to come up with a good diagnosis and start treating. If you give somebody the wrong medication, you cannot take it back. Does that make sense? If you've given a med, oral, IV, doesn't matter what it is. Once it's in, you can't take it back. There are medications at the paramedic level that will last in your system up to 45 days. Days. And that one being amiodarone, which is an anti, which is, in your case, would be known as an antiarrhythmic. It's more in depth than just that, right? 45 days in the system. It's a long time. That's why understanding the pharmacodynamics of a medication, which is what we talked about during pharmacology, is known as the half-life and how long it stays in the system and how long it stays alive, right, before it wears off. All right. So assessment may be difficult with uncooperative or hostile patient. So you want to maintain professional, calm, non-judgmental demeanor at all times, right? Refrain from labeling patients and displaying personal biases. Right, EMS bias is a thing, and it's a very dangerous thing to get into. A frequent caller may have different complaint at this time, and I've seen this happen, and this happened recently where I'm actually very frustrated with a call that a previous crew went on where they had patient bias and did not treat a patient appropriately because, well, we've just been there 15 times before. Well, I don't care how many times you've been there, 100 times in a month. That one time you don't treat the patient because you had patient bias is a time they were truly sick. Right? We had a crew that went out to a call, treated a patient, BLS, to the hospital. Patient ended up having rhabdomyolysis and was admitted to the ICU for 2 weeks. Treated BLS because they decided we treat this patient all the time. There's usually nothing ever wrong with this patient. We'll just transport her BLS. Oh, you missed a lot of stuff. And she almost died. Right? So patient biasism is dangerous.
Morgan talked a lot about that on Sunday. He really went into depth and gave several examples.
Good. All right. So let's talk about scene size up. Okay. So scene safety, BSI, right? Ensure the scene is safe for you, your crew, and your patients. Use standard precautions to determine the number of patients or whether you will need additional help. Determine the NOI. The index of suspicion is your awareness and concern for potential serious underlying or unseen injuries or illnesses, right? We'll cover more about injury patterns when we start talking about trauma, not today. Initiate spinal mobilization if needed. And again, develop a general impression. Perform a rapid exam of the patient after you do ABCs, right? Quickly determine the patient's level of consciousness. Your rapid examination is your rapid trauma assessment or medical assessment. We can do that as well. I wouldn't do that before your ABCs though. ABCs first, then we're going to rapid. And then we're looking for identification of life threats. Quickly determine the patient's level of consciousness utilizing the AVPU scale. What is AVPU?
Alert and oriented, alert to verbal, pain and unresponsive.
Perfect. And we're looking at ABCs, airway and breathing, is in conscious patients, ensure the airway is open, and they are breathing adequately. If they are talking to you in full sentences with no word dyspnea, right, they have a patent airway. Check for rate, rhythm, and quality. Rate, depth, and quality for respiratory rate. For respiratory. Just because they're breathing 10 times a minute doesn't mean they have good adequate depth. You need to have good tidal volume, right? Tidal volume, rate. What is their rhythm? Consider applying oxygen if patient's breathing is being affected. For unconscious patients, make sure you open the airway using a proper technique. Head tilt, chin lift for non-traumatic, traumatic jaw thrust, and take several seconds to evaluate their breathing, right? Take several seconds, look at it. Look at their rate, rhythm, and quality, right? Is it Biot's, chain stokes, right? Kuzmal's? There's different respiratory statuses. We'll cover more of that in respiratory next week. So Zach Evans will be doing the respiratory lecture next Thursday. So he'll be doing that with immunological. Apply oxygen to the patient if necessary. In shock? Yeah. As long as they need oxygen, apply it to them, not under breather. You, again, passing the test, not under breather, 15 liters a minute, put it on the patient, right? When the oxygen, low oxygen saturations are measured, SpO2 less than 94%. It's not just about the number, right? So on Sunday, I will show you guys a cardiac monitor and show you what to look for PLETH, right? PLETH is important. It shows you you're getting an accurate reading. Unconscious patients may need an airway adjunct and ventilatory assistance with a bag valve mask, right? In circulation, in a conscious patient, we're going to check the radial pulse and observe the patient's skin color, temperature, and condition, right? Checking for a pulse. Is it bounding? Is it rapid? Is it slow? Right? What is the skin color and temperature like? If they're pale, cool, clammy, and diaphoretic, we know they're not perfusing right. If they're very hot to the touch, we know they have a potential fever, right? Pink, warm, and dry is what we look for. Not cool, clammy, diaphoretic, not hot to the touch, right? If you have a patient who is hyperthermic and they are no longer sweating, is that a bad thing? Everybody should be saying yes. We'll cover that more in environmental emergencies when your thermal regulators are no longer working. Sweating is designed to cool you down. Shivering is done to warm you up, right? That's how that works. We'll cover more of that in environmental. Transport decision. The following patients should be considered in serious condition and in need of rapid transport. The patient who are unconscious, who have an altered mental status, patients with airway or breathing problems, patient with obvious circulatory problems, such as severe bleeding or signs of shock. The patient does not meet the criteria for rapid transport, continue your assessment on the scene and prepare for transport when you have completed the assessment and treatment that you need. This goes back to, are they sick or not sick? We gotta make that determination. History taking, this is my favorite part of interrogation. All right. So we determine what the problems are or what they may be causing the problem itself. All right. So we're going to gather the history, investigate the NOI, inquire about the chief complaint. Remember, as things get better, chief complaints change. So you have to keep reassessing and talking to your patient. For the unconscious patient, where we have implied consent with that, survey the scene, medication containers, and medical devices. Right? Or like medical alert bracelets, things like that. Medication containers. Did they overdose? Right? Are there pills on the ground? Right? So things to think about. Look at everything. You also get a pretty decent medical history looking at their medication bottles as well. There we go. Obtain a sample history and OPQRST, which we already covered. Record any allergies, medication conditions, and medications, or medical conditions, medications. And some patients also take numerous medications as well. So take a list with you, okay? If they have it, if not, bring their bottles. We want to make sure that they're accurate, okay? Because anytime a patient gets admitted to a med surge or ICU, the nursing staff in the ER, they have to go through every medication and do verification with the dose, the name, the dose, and how often they take it. Whether it be daily, weekly, monthly, hourly, you know, twice a day, three times a day. And we look at our secondary assessment. So the secondary assessment may occur on scene or en route to the emergency department. In some cases, you may not have time to conduct a secondary assessment, depending on the stability of the patient, if they're really sick or not, right? And if they have an airway issue, you may not get past the airway management, right? But physical examinations on all conscious patients should undergo a limited or detailed physical assessment or examination based on their chief complaint. For an unconscious patient, you're doing a head-to-toe. Full body assessment should help you obtain clues and should be performed quickly so it does not delay transport. Now, if they're elderly, 90 years old with some dementia, and they let you try to get a full body assessment, they may be missing something, right? If the basic condition warrants a secondary assessment, again, head to toe, but this one here should take you about 5 minutes or so. Be detailed, right? Did Morgan go over rapid trauma assessments with you guys? Head to toe?
Yeah, he did. I would like to see, and I don't know if everybody else is in the same boat as me, but, you know, when I was thinking assessment, I was thinking one cookbook, you know, set way, and I didn't know that there was trauma versus non-trauma. So it'd be nice if we get into that in the next couple of weeks, and I think we will.
We'll do it Sunday.
But yeah, right. Good.
It got a little confusing.
It was, yeah.
My biggest thing right now is getting you guys past the trauma assessment station. The rest of the stuff I like to call monkey skills because they're easy, but the assessment is can be confusing, but it's actually not that bad. It's memorizing the order. But I will go over the in-detailed trauma assessment, and we'll also go over the rapid and in-detailed exam plus a focused. We'll do all that on Sunday. It'll just be me there. So
the biggest thing is that if we could just see one from start to finish. Well,
believe me, I'll do an assessment on one of you guys. Don't worry. I'll make sure you guys get a lot of hands-on stuff, and I'll show you guys how to do a proper assessment from the beginning. So we'll definitely go over it in detail. I'll break it right down into groups, into categories.
Cool.
Awesome.
Sections. So if the patient's condition warrants the secondary assessment again, it's head-to-toe, but slow. Methodical. Go right down through everything. Treatment depends on the conditions found at your local protocols. We'll cover that later. All right. Vital signs. Assess for pulse rate, rhythm, quality, regularity at the most appropriate site. Start at a radial, then work your way up. But do check cap refill on dorsal pedals or tibials. Okay. We just want to make sure we're checking those because just because they have a radial pulse does not mean their heart is squeezing enough to perfuse the lower extremities farther away from the heart. Right. So people stop at a radial. Don't. I'm not saying you need to check a popliteal or ephemeral, but go down to the dorsal pedal or the tibial and check for those. And if you find it, take a pen and mark it on their skin, right? You have my permission to write on the patient's skin, right? Make a mark, right? Blood pressure. Measuring both systolic and diastolic pressures. Do not do them by palp, right? Get a top number and a bottom number and check both arms, right? If they are having a triple A, the pressures will be different. If they're having a stroke, the pressures potentially could be different from one to the other, right? Don't forget if a patient is very hypovolemic and they're hypotensive or they had a syncope, check orthostatic blood pressures. And remind me on Sunday and I'll show you guys orthostatics, okay? Remind me on Sunday for orthostatic blood pressure. Someone write that down because I'll forget in like 20 minutes.
Got it.
Write it down for me. We'll go over orthostatics as part of our assessment for syncope.
Got it.
Written. Right. Respiratory rate, rhythm, and quality. What kind of condition are they in? Right. Considering using automatic blood pressure cuff for future assessment at regular intervals, 5 or 15. But your first set really should be manual. That gives you a good baseline set. Right, blood glucose, pulse oximetry. What else is not on here is end tidal CO2, pupillary response, temperature. Right, you should be checking pupils, body temperature, and patients that require end tidal, right? Capnography for those that need it. And then your reassessments. So once the assessment and treatment have been completed, you want to reassess and should begin and continue throughout transport. Repeat the primary assessment, reassess the chief complaint, consider the need for ALS backup again, repeat your physical examination to identify and treat any changes in the patient's condition. Vital signs 5-15, review and treatment, all treatments that you've performed. Is the patient getting better or are they getting worse? All right. And document the changes that developed as a result of the treatments, and if needed, adjust any of the treatments accordingly. Right. So if you give a patient nitro and you assist with patient nitroglycerin, right, after you give a nitroglycerin, right, rephrase that. Before you give nitro, you want to obtain a 12-lead EKG, okay? Before you give nitro, obtain a 12-lead EKG. After you've administered it, 5 minutes later, get another 12-lead, right? If a patient is having, and this is not within your level, but I'm going to explain it to you. If a patient is having ST depression, which is an ischemic heart, and you give nitro and vasodilate, either the patient's going to start getting better and the ST depression is going to go away, or the myocardial infarction is going to be getting worse with a worse blockage, right? Making you go from elevation depression to elevation. It can change past the isoelectric line on an EKG. Again, nothing you guys need to be worried about, but for the paramedic, you call for the intercept. 5 minute interval, anytime you give nitro before you administer it, get a 12 lead. So we can see those changes as you are doing medications. Any questions on that at all? In Maine and New Hampshire, 12 lead EKGs are a basic level skill. And I will be going over the scope of practice module of 12 leads with you guys, right? Myself or Morgan, one of the two, will be doing that one of our Sundays here.
We don't have to interpret all of the stuff on the monitor. We just need to learn how to set it up.
Set it up and acquire it.
Starts recording what's going
yes,
on.
Yes. Yes. Putting in the analyze and printing it off. And then transmitting it to the hospital you're transporting to. Now, you can tell me computer interpretation states sinus tachycardia. Okay? Because it prints it off and tells you what it is. You can't do a manual reading, but you can read what it says on the strip itself. As long as you document computer interpretation states, therefore you are not interpreting an EKG.
Yeah.
Right. The machine is doing it for you. All right. Most medical emergencies require a level of treatment beyond that available in pre-hospital setting. It may require advanced testing available in a hospital. X-rays, CTs, ultrasounds, bladder scans. Labs like CBC, CMPs, LFTs, troponin, lactate, all these different things that they can utilize inside of a hospital to do more further testing, right? We need to get them to that definitive care, right? It may also be beyond the scope of an EMT to administer medications to a patient, right? Depending on what medications, you can do some and some you can't. So any administration of a medication by an EMT requires direct permission from med control. That is not true, all right? Oxygen, oral glucose, aspirin, right? Those are all standing orders, not medical control orders. They're standing orders from your physician, right? So be familiar with the state protocols that you're utilizing. EMTs can also use an AED on a patient who is pulseless and apneic, right? Now, the services that I work for, we do not carry AEDs. We have cardiac monitors that have an AED function to them. Right, but they're a full cardiac monitor. I'll go over all that with you guys on Sunday for CPR. Scene time may be longer for medical patients than trauma patients, right? We want to make sure that we're transporting a patient within 20 minutes of patient contact. That is our goal. And any more than 20 minutes, you have to explain why in your narrative and why you went longer than 20 minutes, right? Prolonged extrication. Psychiatric patient not willing to go with us to the hospital, but document why. Critical patients always need rapid transport. They include patients altered mental status, airway breathing issues, with any signs of circulatory compromise, or if they're very old or very young, when you just need to get moving. Neuropathy plays a huge part in elderly, and they can mask a lot of the symptoms. Medications like metoprolol, being a beta blocker, can mask tachycardia in patients that are septic, because it already drops the heart rate down as it is, and it holds it there, blocking beta receptors.
People who are diabetic, actually, with neuropathy.
Yep.
I learned that with my dad, who had cardiac problems. You know, they'd ask him what his pain was, and he's like, it's probably a 4. They're like, okay, so that's an 8, because they don't feel things the same.
Correct. And females present differently than males do, right? Males have the tip. Sometimes males have the typical signs and symptoms of cardiac, where females, they may be like, oh, I just have some shoulder pain, and they have a full-blown MI, right? Diabetics might only have upper gastric pain, and that's it, and they're having a full-blown heart attack because of the neuropathy. So if life-threatening conditions exist, transportation should include lights and sirens. If the patient is not critical, consider non-emergent transport, right? No lights, no sirens, get to the hospital when you get over there. Modes of transport ultimately come from one of two categories, ground or air. That's it for the medical patient. Now, obviously, there's wheelchair vans and things like that, but that's not in the emergent setting. Right, ground transport. EMS units are typically staffed by EMTs and paramedics. You can see there's a Boston EMS ambulance here in the picture. Air medical transport, staffed by critical care providers, nurses, paramedics, higher scope of practice. Destination selection, obviously, generally the closest hospital should be your destination. Sometimes the patient may benefit from going to another hospital that is capable of handling his or her particular condition. So know your resources in the area, who can do what, and contact medical control. Right. I know that if I have a patient that has a urology issue, right, and I know that Huggins and Memorial cannot handle it, Lakes Region and Laconia can. So I may call med control to bypass to go to a hospital that can handle it versus transferring them out. Heart attacks, these small hospitals out here do not have PCI centers. Closest one for us is Dover, right, for anything in this area. Right. Know your centers and what their capabilities are. That's your job to know that, not my job to teach it. Right. Know your local protocols and what you have. Infectious disease, general assessment principles, approach the patient with an infectious disease like any other medical patient. Right. If they have an infectious disease, make sure you're wearing masks, gowns, whatever you need to do to protect yourself. Scene size up, take precautions, complete your primary assessment, and use your OPQRST to elaborate on the patient's chief complaint. Sample history again. Right, what's going on today, and ask whether the patient has recently traveled or has come in contact with someone who has traveled. What are they thinking about here?
Like communicable diseases?
Yeah, like Mycobacterium tuberculosis. So TB. So Mycobacterium tuberculosis. That's its own category of bacteria, by the way, if you guys didn't know that. So really quick off topic stuff, but there's what they call gram positive, gram negative, and Mycobacterium are the 3 different types of bacteria that are out there. Pretty cool under a microscope too, when they do gram staining, pretty neat. All right, so general management principles, obviously focus on any life-threatening condition identified in the primary assessment, right? So be empathetic. Yeah, you have to have feelings, by the way, to be in this job. It's not a heartless job at all. All right. You got to talk to your patients, be empathetic and sympathetic. You're going to place the patient in the position of comfort on the stretcher and keep them warm. Standard precautions. Always follow your agency's exposure control plan and cleaning equipment. Every agency by state law has to have an exposure control plan. Not just for how you decon, but if you get exposed as well and who you notify. And that is requirement. It also required for you to understand what they are with the agency you work for. If you have not done that, it's a Bureau of Labor from Maine. It's a Bureau of Labor fine. Right. And by the way, it's $1,000 fine per incident, per violation. That's the Maine Bureau of Labor for you. Epidemic or pandemic considerations. I don't know if I really need to go over pandemics anymore. We just lived through one and we're still dealing with it. Right. But an epidemic is a new case of a disease in a human population substantially exceeded what is expected. But a pandemic is an outbreak that occurs globally. So COVID-19. Remember, though, that coronavirus has been around for a very, 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 very long time. This is just a man-made strain that killed a lot of people. Right. Common or serious communicable diseases, influenza. So those, remember, there's two different types, influenza A, influenza B. Those with chronic medical conditions, compromised immune systems, right? Like patients on chemotherapy would have low white counts, like almost non-existent white counts that fight off infection, right? White blood cells are good to have, just not excess. High white blood cell counts usually indicate infection. Very, very low usually means that they're immunocompromised by something. The very young and the very old are most susceptible to complications of influenza, right? Now, more people have died from influenza. Oh my God, I can't speak tonight. More people have passed on from influenza than they ever have with COVID, right? So transmitted by direct contact with nasal secretions and aerosolized droplets from coughing and sneezing by infected people. What medication do we give that gives aerosolized products?
Isn't that like the MDI we talked about?
Yeah, and also albuterol treatments as well.
Nebulizers.
Which is starting to come into the BLS skill, right? So if you give somebody an albuterol or Duoneb treatment in the field, and they're smoking that peace pipe, which is what you give them, it's aerosolizing into the lungs, and they exhale, where does all that go? Into the air that you're breathing in the back of the ambulance. So it's very safe to turn on the vents in the ambulance to suck things out and wear a mask if you're giving a nebulizer. Protect yourself.
Hey, Kevin, I got a question about PPE and, I'm the safety guy for all of our offices in New England. So I'm constantly watching the county levels that they have. Are there any, is there any time right now with COVID that if a certain level gets reached in a certain county that they make you guys mask, or is that like not even a thing?
It's going to be a recommendation and whatever the CDC recommends.
So if the county is if like I'm looking at what we have in the USGS right now. So we, when a county, the new hospital admissions rate per 100,000 population in a county goes to high, we have to wear masks at work. Is that what they go off of?
So we go by whatever the CDC recommends.
Yeah.
So if the CDC tells the state office that we have to be back in masks, then we'll be back in masks. Now, is it required now? No. Is it optional? Absolutely. Right. However, patients with Mycobacterium tuberculosis, anything that airborne pathogen, we are required to wear HEPA filters, HEPA respirators, N95 masks anyways, right? Because it's a very, very contagious respiratory disease.
And the EMTs, paramedics, and do you guys have to follow the OSHA rules with, you have to have a medical clearance, you have to be fit tested and all that stuff? Do you guys follow those rules?
That's a great question. In Maine, you do. In New Hampshire, you do not.
Cool.
Yeah, Maine, you have to be fit tested for the N95 mask. You also have to go through a pulmonary function test because it's considered a respirator, and you have to follow the age rule recommendations of less than 35, 35 to 40, and over 40. In New Hampshire, there's no requirement. We do recommend fit testing, but that's not required.
Live free or die.
That's right. Live free or get COVID, I guess. So again, always wear PPE, gloves, eye protection, HEPA respirators, N95 masks at a minimum for these patients with anything airborne or anything like immunocompromised patients. If you have an immunocompromised patient in the back of your ambulance, put a mask on them, even if they're not like TB or COVID. Protect them, right? They can't fight infection anymore. Their white count is white, right? So if you have a patient who's on chemo, put a mask on them, put one on yourself. Even if you don't want to wear one, doesn't matter. It's not about you. It's about the patient. It's like trauma patients in the summertime. You're sweating your butt off outside, but a trauma patient becomes hypothermic quickly due to blood loss, right? So you got to cover them up and crank the heat in the ambulance. It's not about making you comfortable. It's about making the patient comfortable. And it's going to suck for a little bit. But it's what's best for the patient. All right. So make sure you're wearing your HEPA filters, N95s, whatever it may be. Some states like Maine require TB testing every year too. And they also require that you have the hepatitis B series completed as well. If you choose not to get it, then you can sign a declination form. Or if you get it, it's not back on the service. But the state of Maine requires that the service pay for it. So it does not come out of your pocket. If you work for a Maine service, the service has to, not required by law, offer you tuberculosis and hepatitis series to be started. They also have to pay for your pulmonary function tests and everything else too. Let's keep that in mind. It's like driver training in Maine as well. You're required to have that within the first 6 months of hire, and they have to provide it to you. Herpes simplex, very common viral strain carried by humans. Symptomatic infections cause eruptions of tiny little fluid-filled blisters called vesicles that appear on the lips or the genitals. Right? This can cause more serious illness like pneumonia and meningitis in the very young and very old, and immunocompromised patients as well. So the primary mode of infection is through close personal contact. So standard precautions are generally sufficient to prevent spread to or from healthcare workers. HIV infection, EMTs face a risk of exposure to the virus that causes AIDS on a regular basis. AIDS can still be fatal, however, with treatment, the patient can expect a near normal lifespan, right? So if you have a potential IV stick, go get treated. They'll put you on the I almost said anaphylaxis. It's not anaphylaxis. What am I thinking of? I'm drawing a blank on the word. It's called
antiviral.
Yeah, it's like antiviral, but oh my God. I'm sure I'll think of it after the thing. It begins with an A. I'm just drawing a blank. Either way, they start you on the medicine for it.
But don't they test you and the patient?
Yes.
I mean, because you can ask for that.
But can the patient refuse?
I don't think so.
Look up the Ryan White paper. Ryan Whitelaw. They can refuse it, yes. Hmm. It's their body. They have the right to refuse. Now, I don't think I've ever seen anybody ever refuse it before. But patients do have rights. If they refuse, they're just going to start you on the prophylactic. That's what I was thinking of.
Yeah.
They're going to start you on the prophylactic series for that as well.
It's called post-exposure prophylactic.
What was that? Sorry, I lost you.
Post-exposure prophylaxis.
Thank you. I don't want to say this over the day. I knew I'd think of it eventually, though. I was on the tip of my tongue, and I couldn't get it off my tongue. I'm like, what is it called? So HIV infection obviously potentially hazardous when deposited on mucous membranes or directly into the bloodstream. Mucous membranes, nose, mouth, eyes. That's why we need to stay protected, right? Your risk of infection is limited to exposure of an infected patient's blood and bodily fluids, right? If you get blood on your skin, it's very limited. But if you have an open cut, a little higher. Direct injection into your veins, absolutely, right? Many patients with HIV show no symptoms at all. So always make sure you wear the proper type of gloves, okay? Non-latex is what we wear. Take great care in handling the improperly disposable needles. Right? A lot of them now are all retractable, but again, things do fail. Cover any open wounds that you have whenever you're on a job. So if you have an open wound in the hand, make sure you bandage it up, band-aids, make sure you wear your gloves. If you think the patient's blood or secretions have entered your system, seek medical advice as soon as possible. And you have to notify your infectious control disease, or which is called a DICO or a DICO, DICO, which is a designated infection control officer. hepatitis, inflammation, right? And often infection of the liver, right? Can be caused by a number of different viruses and toxins for inflammation for hepatitis. There's hepatitis A, B, C, D, E, F, G. You have to have A and C to have F. I don't know. There's all these different ones that are out there, right? Again, the most common ones we see are hepatitis A, B, and C. Hepatitis A is fecal matter, so please don't go playing in people's poop, right? They do have a two-shot series that you can get for hepatitis A. Hepatitis B is a three-shot series, right? There isn't one for hepatitis C at this point in time that I know of. Maybe I could be wrong. So hepatitis A can be transmitted only from a patient who has an acute infection, whereas hepatitis B and hepatitis C can be transmitted from long-term carriers who have no signs or of illness. A carrier is a person or animal in whom an infectious organism has taken up the permanent residence and may or may not cause an active disease. Hepatitis A is transmitted orally through oral or fecal contamination. B is far more contagious than HIV, and vaccinations with Hep B vaccine is highly recommended for EMTs. All right, clear as mud with that one. I honestly cannot see this table at all. It's so small on my screen. But here's a table of something. What is it saying? Oh, characteristics of hepatitis. I had to go a little bigger and that's to see it. So as you can kind of see how it works through, I'm not going to sit here and read all these to you guys. They're in your ebooks or your textbooks. Be familiar with these, right? But I'm not saying memorize them in detail. Meningitis. There's two types, right? Bacterial and viral. Inflammation of the meningeal coverings of the brain and spinal cord, right? And when we get into medical emergencies more in depth, I'll teach you guys how to test for this in the field. Most forms of meningitis are not contagious. One form, meningococcal meningitis, is highly contagious, okay? So take standard precautions. Gloves and masks will go a long way to prevent the patient's secretions from getting into your nose and mouth, right? Vaccines are rarely used. So meningitis can be treated in the emergency department with antibiotics. And after treating a patient with meningitis, contact your employer health representative. All right. TB, tuberculosis, otherwise known as mycobacterium tuberculosis, is the most infected patients are well most of the time, but a chronic mycobacterial disease, right, that causes, though, that usually strikes the lungs itself. It's its own bacteria, right? It's a specialized one just for tuberculosis. So mycobacterial. Diseases that occur shortly after infection are called primary tuberculosis, right? You can get a TB test done. Literally, it's a sub-Q injection under the skin. And in 48 hours, if it turns red and blotchy, you've had TB at some point in time in your life. If it doesn't turn red and blotchy, then you're perfectly fine. If it does, then you're going to be requested to go in for a chest x-ray to kind of see what's going on. Reactive tuberculosis is common and can be much more difficult to treat. The patients who pose a high risk almost always have a cough. So consider respiratory tuberculosis to be the only contagious form of because the only one that is spread by airborne transmission. Droplet nuclei, or the remains of the droplets produced by the cough after excess water has evaporated. So we are required to wear an N95 or HEPA mask, right, to stop that droplet nuclei that's there. With that being said, surgical masks do not work for this, okay? Doesn't even work for COVID, right? It still gets through it. N95s, ENVOs, those things like that that have the proper ENVOs and the proper filters in them, yes. I have my own ENVO I keep in my vehicle to bring to work with me. So absolute protection from infection from the bacillus, does not exist. So according to the CDC, 1/3 of the world's population is infected with tuberculosis. The mechanism of transmission is not very efficient. So having tuberculosin skin tests regularly, so that TB test, what they call it, right? Again, so if the infections be found before you become ill, preventative therapy is almost 100% effective. So if you test positive, you'll get checked out and confirmed with a chest x-ray, and then they can start giving you some treatment for it. But again, once you've started becoming symptomatic, and then once you've had it, you have it forever. It's always in your system. And it can be actually seen on a chest x-ray. Whooping cough, which is not so much now because we have the Tdaps, but the DPTs we'll talk about here in a second. So also called pertussis, whooping cough is an airborne disease caused by bacteria that most likely affects children younger than the age of 6. I think in the 25 years I've been doing this, I've had one patient with whooping cough. Croup, a lot. Whooping cough, no. Symptoms include fever and a whoop sound that occurs when inhaling after a coughing attack. The best way to prevent exposure is to be vaccinated with what they call a DPT or Tdap. They can also place a mask on the patient and yourself as well. Again, people that are anti-vaxxers, though, these are the ones that are going to have this cause.
A few years ago, several churches it went through.
Yep.
Because they were anti-vaxxers.
Yep. All right. So we're almost done. You guys want to take a break or just want to plow through it and get it done over with?
All right. My vote is to go.
Just keep going.
Yeah.
Perfect. So MRSA, M-R-S-A, methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus. Right, MRSA is a bacterium that causes infection and is resistant to many antibiotics. In healthcare settings, MRSA is transmitted from patient to patient by unwashed hands of healthcare providers. We are the ones that are not cleaning our hands. Okay, and now hand washing is the best. 99.9% of the time, all right, your hand sanitizers kill germs, 99.9% of the germs. There's still that 0.1% that's still there that you're still carrying around. Wash your hands with soap and water before you go into a room, after you get out of a room, even if you're wearing gloves. Right? Because we are the ones that are spreading MRSA from patient to patient. Right? Protect yourselves, protect other people. MRSA can be respiratory. It can be in a wound. Right? And we don't want MRSA because a lot of antibiotics do not work with it, right? Factors that increase the risk of developing MRSA include antibiotic therapy, right? And not just like one dose, like consistent antibiotic therapy can start MRSA. Prolonged hospital stays, a stay in the intensive care or burn unit, exposure to an infected patient. My God, everything seems to be in a hospital, huh?
So well, most MRSA is acquired in the hospital.
Yes, it's like hospital acquired pneumonia. Like
MRSA. Tend to get MRSA by being in a hospital setting.
Here's an interesting one for you, too. The incubation period for MRSA, 5 to 45 days. Incubation period. MRSA results in a soft tissue infection. Signs and symptoms will be localized skin abscesses and sepsis in older patients. MRSA can kill you. All right. So the global health issues, 2019 coronavirus. All right. In Wuhan, China. Quickly spread, affecting millions, killing hundreds of thousands, right? You guys are fortunate you were not in the healthcare field. Some of you might have been in the healthcare field during that time. It put a strain on healthcare workers like you wouldn't believe. And I lost a lot of good people, not to death, but to the job, because they're like, we're done. We're burnt out. People being sick, being forced over, working 150 hours a week. But you couldn't go home because you couldn't leave ambulances unstaffed, right? Patients being intubated, us wearing full encapsulated suits in the back of the ambulances to protect ourselves, right? Using cappers and pappers and everything else that were out there. So there, we went through a lot. That was a very tough 2-year period of time where we were so protected until the Delta variant and the original COVID-19 dissipated. And now it's making a comeback and people are getting sick again, not to the point of intubation, but they're getting pretty sick. Dehydration, electrolyte imbalances, and things like that. Symptoms include fever, cough, shortness of breath, and appear 2 to 14 days after exposure to the infected person. 2 to 14 days after exposure, right? Now, any one of you guys in the class could have been a carrier of COVID at one point in time with no symptoms, asymptomatic. You show up to work and you start coughing. Maybe you cough once, you spread it to everybody else in work, the whole entire shift is off, things like that, right? For current updates on COVID-19, use the CDC website to kind of say current what's going on. I know we've been beat to death with it, but again, you got to do the best you can. Let's see. Middle East Respiratory Syndrome Coronavirus. The first human case was discovered in 2012 in Saudi Arabia. Most human infections are found in the Middle East, right? Cases of the COVID have been found in Europe and the United States. If you suspect this, please wear a surgical mask as well and notify the receiving facility. Ebola. I remember when Ebola was, oh my God, we're going to get Ebola everywhere. It happened in Texas with like 6 people and we never saw it again. So 2014, the outbreak of Ebola virus in West Africa would spread infection, and then people traveled across countries. Incubation period is 6 to 12 days. Symptoms may not appear as long as 21 days after the infection. Fatality rate can be as high as 70% if treatment in the ICU is not initiated promptly. This was a big scare when it first came out. I remember 2014 when oh my God, Ebola. And we had to put these Ebola suits on the ambulance. It sat on my ambulance for like 4 years and no one ever put one on because we were in small town Maine. But the CDC said we had to have them. So we put them on all these trucks and they sat there, spent a lot of money on this stuff. Doesn't mean it doesn't exist, but it's there. Travel medicine. You must be aware of travel acquired infections and assessing a patient who was recently outside the United States. Ask that question if they are sick. Have you traveled outside the United States in the last 14 days? Patients present with a variety of symptoms, including fever, cough, vomiting, bloody diarrhea, body aches, and rashes. So when you encounter an ill patient with a recent travel history, place a mask on the patient and gather as much information as you possibly can. Put one on yourself too, by the way. Right, important questions to ask. We have 2 more slides. This one and the next one. So important questions to ask would include, where did you recently travel? Did you receive any vaccinations before your trip? All right. Were you exposed to any infectious disease? Is there anyone else in your travel party who is sick? What types of foods did you eat? What was the source of the drinking water, like Mexico? if you suspect the patient has a communicable disease, follow your PPE guidelines and notify the receiving facility, right? They have something called negative pressure rooms, but they have to make sure there's not another patient in there that's not negative pressure required to clean that room out. So if you have a patient with COVID or a patient that has any kind of airborne pathogen, notify the hospital when you're still on scene so they can start prepping for it. So in conclusion, the assessment and treatment of a medical patient can be challenging and interesting because of the nature of the medical condition. Okay. So again, keep calm, be prepared to handle any combination of conditions, right? And then look at all your symptoms and start treating. Use differentials. Remember, you don't want to be that person to give nitro to a stroke patient because they had chest pain. Look at everything. All right. Let's do some review questions and we'll call it a night. So a seizure patient is having what kind of medical emergency?
Neurological C.
C it is. Number 2, if an injury distracts an EMT from assessing more than if an injury distracts an EMT from assessing a more serious underlying illness, the EMT has now suffered from what?
A tunnel vision.
Yeah, tunnel vision. Exactly. Number 3, if a frequent flyer calls 911 because of a suspected head injury, you should never do what?
C.
Yeah.
Assume you know what the problem is.
Yep, see it is. Number 4, if your medical patient is not in critical condition, not, how long should you spend on seeing?
A.
This is a tough one because I told you guys something and this is different than what here. The answer is D, however long it takes. Okay. That's a national registry answer. We should not be on scene more than 20 minutes either way. Right. We'll try to get the patient moving, but still do your assessment. Number five, the patient is having respiratory difficulty and is not responding to your treatment. What is the best method of transport?
C.
I would say B. I mean, B.
I say B.
Yeah, I would go with B as well. Lights and sirens to the closest hospital, right? Air medical transport, not really required for respiratory difficulty. Critical access can usually handle these patients. Call for ALS backup as well. All right, so number six. When assessing a patient with an infectious disease, what is the first action you should perform?
A.
Definitely right. Not D. Definitely not D.
A it is. All right, number seven. Your patient believes he has hepatitis and is now exhibiting signs of cirrhosis in the liver. He most likely has what?
C.
Hepatitis C.
The liver. All right. Number eight. Your patient is complaining of a fever, headache, stiffness of the neck, and red blotches on his skin.
D.
I didn't cover this very much in depth.
D.
All right.
D.
So the answer is D. And the reason being is
stiffness of neck.
This one right here. Right here. And the red blotches too. Right? But a fever and a headache and neck stiffness. So what we tell them to do as part of our assessment is touch your chin to your chest. And if it causes significant pain with a fever, headache, and red blotches, meningitis. Right. Number nine, what should you do if you are exposed to a patient who is found to have pulmonary tuberculosis?
B.
Yeah, it's good. A skin test.
You might need therapy after.
Right? Yes. All the following are factors that increase the risk of developing MRSA, except
E.
D. Birds.
And birds. Yeah, answer is D. All right. So that is all I have for you.
Oh, cool.
I don't want to keep you guys
Sunday
up.
Sunday 9, right?
What was that?
9 on Sunday.
The class will start at 9 o'clock, yes.
Okay.
Action Ambulance, 570 Plain Road, Hamworth, New Hampshire.
Correct.
Bye. Do we have to read the BLS chapter in the book before?
You can if you want to, but I'm not testing you guys for the AOS certification. You're doing AHA.
Okay.
All right. I do not test you guys in AOS. They have their own CPR program. I do not use it. Not a lot of the places accept it. They accept the American Heart Association. So feel free. You can look at the chapter. CPR is still CPR. So if you want to review that chapter for then, but I'm not going to quiz you on it. Your quiz will be on the AHA stuff, which is 25 questions. And it's a paper test you guys will do in-house.
Okay.
Phone a friend. Google.
Phone a friend.
Exactly. All right. Let me turn this recording off really quick here. And then...
But Tamworth, Tamworth for me is not that...